Voilà, écoutez, merci beaucoup de...
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the room. We're not going to waste any more time. So if the last stragglers could take a seat, and we're going to try and win back the 5 minutes that we just lost at the coffee break, so that everybody has time to ask their questions. And so that we can have a longer Q&A session as well at the end. So if you could all just settle down. And now we are going to begin our second session. And we're going to be talking about patient experience collecting to share decision making. And of course, we have again our guest speaker, Angela Coulter, with us. Thank you very much. And a round of applause for Angela. Well worth the round of applause. I'd also like to introduce our other speakers for this second session. First of all, we have Martine Bungener, economist, sociologist, emeritus research director, CNRS and CERMES S3, with the patient associations at INSEM. Then we also have Philip van der Weijs, a senior researcher, Scientific Institute for Quality of Healthcare, IQ Healthcare, from the Radboud University, Nijmegen Medical Center, Netherlands. Welcome to you as well. And beside you, we have Karen Sipucha, who is assistant professor of medicine, Harvard Medical School. Welcome. You recognize Arlene Bierman, a director, Center for Evidence and Practice Improvement, Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality from the US. Welcome, Arlene. And we'll also have, sitting on the stage as well for the roundtable discussion, we also have Catherine Grenier, director for the Improvement of Healthcare Quality and Safety at the HAS. And also, we have Catherine Cerise, Vice Chair, Cancer Contribution Association, Administrator, Europa Donor, and member of the Patient Information Commission as well at the HAS. So welcome to you too. Cutting straight to the chase, in this session, we're going to be talking about how we listen to patient voices and how we use these voices as a means to improve patient care and treatment, and how to involve them more. Therefore, we'll be looking at the channels for collecting passenger experience, patient experience, and we'll also be talking about concerns in terms of practice, and also how to build the structures and the means for collecting and listening to patient voices, and how to organize this in the context of professional healthcare professionals. We're going to have a look now at this from a qualitative and quantitative point of view in a video. And as Agnès Buzyn explained this morning, this is a presentation of eSatis, which is a patient satisfaction survey method. Here we are. When patients are in hospital in France, they have the opportunity to make their opinions heard. A fortnight after leaving hospital, they receive an email with a satisfaction questionnaire. Well, the advantage of this questionnaire means that we can measure satisfaction more broadly, not just about treatment, but from other aspects as well. This is work to do. We work with eSatis. We have working groups that drafted the questionnaire. We also work with trial questionnaires that were trialed with patient groups who volunteered in our network. and this has been done in association with the HAS. And I would say that these voices were taken into account. E-Satis, I think, is a major step forward because it's a way for patients to express their views about treatment that they've been receiving, and it's also an opportunity to help subsequent patients. E-Satis was very important for our hospital because we had our own satisfaction survey method, but now we have a national system, and this allows us to benchmark ourselves against others. Our nurse teams are aware of this, and also it's important for them to be aware of the ratings that they receive. I think one of the major contributions of E-Certis is not just an opportunity for patients to make their voices heard, but also see how this has an impact on subsequent care. Close-knit teams is always an advantage and adds to the quality of care. Lack of coordination between carers, doctors, etc., is less pleasant. It was really a pleasure to have my child here because of the quality of the care. In E-Satis, we realized that satisfaction was always seen as a marginal aspect of care. So that means that today, treatment is not only measured in terms of the efficiency of care, but also in terms of the patient satisfaction. And this, therefore, can contribute to quality management. And also, by listening to people's claims, we could work on improving treatment. Obviously, E-Satis isn't the same as making a claim, because E-Satis also collects feedback from patients, which is positive, not just negative. And sometimes the negative comments are different from what we expected. So the advantage of E-Satis is that it gives structure to indicators and is also helps to balance just negative complaints as well with positive input.
Voilà, alors nous allons voir à présent.
Now we're going to see how to involve patients and medical professionals in the decision-making process, how to manage all the information that is collected. And this is our first point of discussion with Martine Bungener, who is economist and sociologist and head of research, emeritus research at CNRS. So listening to the patient from a qualitative survey, you have the floor. Thank you very much for this opportunity to speak to you and also the wealth of discussions that we're having today. It's an opportunity for us to listen to the voice of other research as well, who we're usually used to reading only, whereas here we have them face to face. This morning, we've been hearing about trials and positive experiments, but we also heard on several occasions the cultural context, and this is something I would like to focus on now in order to draw your attention to the fact that in order to have to listen to the voice of the patient and engagement, it means that the socio-cultural environment and historical context has to be conducive to gathering these opinions and voices, which is not always a given. Now, I'm going to go quite quickly over this because I don't have much time. To give you a bit of background, in France, but could apply elsewhere as well. We are at a juncture where we're seeing major progress being made in medicine, more and more efficient treatments. And unconsciously, we are perhaps marginalizing the unspoken care, sort of home care, etc. And by marginalizing the relations with families and patients, this means that their voice became inaudible. This was progressive. It wasn't just a sudden change. But methods and processes led to the fact that we gradually realized that patients were becoming invisible, or at least weren't being taken into account, as opposed to other players on the scene, such as professionals, etc. So what we can see today is that it's taken time for the patient voice to emerge again, and from an invisible voice, we've arrived at a situation to where this voice has been restricted or constrained and formatted by the medical environment, leads to a third step where these voices are becoming more audible, and we can look now at what that means. So very quickly, why is this cultural change so slow? What are the obstacles to changing attitudes? I think it's due in part to the very scientifically based medical process, which led to a long-term break, or certainly in France, between efficient care on the one hand and more all-round care, which was less connected with efficiency. And this meant that the medical world became very hierarchized. There was a hierarchy in the medical world, and we were focusing entirely on efficiency. And this mentality still exists today. So there is a loss of confidence between the various players in this world. A lack of understanding then emerges of the patient experience and family experience. And this translates into a lack of time spent listening to a patient feedback and exchange. And so, based on all of this, a very brief slide to give you a bit of context again for my work. It's the result of many years of work. And this is the first topics I was working on in the hospital environment, where you very clearly see that patients had to become very invisible at the end of the 70s, the beginning of the 80s. Patient voices had very little opportunity to make their voice heard. And more importantly, they weren't even aware of what their medical notes were saying, so they had nothing to speak about. So after this first step in this first phase of research, I worked with a number of associations working with patients in mental care. And here we can see that there is a first step towards working more closely with the patient, listening to their voice, working with patients who have specialized care, and bringing them back into the community. And again, this was thanks to momentum given by patient associations. So patients were gradually taken more into account, and this led to a forum for having patients, letting them have their say, but it was still within a very constrained and medicalized environment. And it was more via sort of ticking boxes in a questionnaire that was very formatted. Now, in France, we are moving into an era where more and more patients are being asked for feedback. They are being given an increasingly large opportunity to speak out, leading to more qualitative listening, more qualitative taking into account of a patient experience. And here we move on to the qualitative approach. So here is to use an inductive sociological approach in the medical environment in order to perceive what are the main categories and main topics that are important for patients, to have a comprehensive approach and a narrative type of medicine. So this is a subjective personal experience in the broad sense of the term, with causal links within that narrative. And this has led to the opportunity to choose and to act. And so this is based on the Amartya Sen approach, Nobel Prize winner. I can't go into the detail of that, but all that just to say, via these narratives, we can see what are the emerging themes, what is important in what the patient is saying, and what is important for the patient. So it's obliging us in a way to take into account the feelings of the patient, what is important for them. And this is an opportunity as well to change the prism through which we see medicine, on the way we approach medicine, and also the way we measure overall outcome. The underlying idea which emerges here is obtaining a final outcome in terms of improvement, and we realize that sometimes the outcome is insufficient because the absolute outcome is not the only factor which is important. Because the patient, the outcome for the patient is not necessarily what they are, what is important for them. So this means that we're changing the focus to what the important outcome for the patient and not necessarily just the medical outcome. And this is what I talk about when I'm talking about a global outcome, an overall outcome. And so here we have a means to achieve that overall outcome, which is the outcome which is valued by the patient. And here again, this is a broader expression and an opportunity to see what the patient is saying. And it's also a reminder it's also another way of expressing empowerment of the patient. And so it's giving the patient an opportunity to choose, to express what they prefer. And the conclusion, therefore, that I wanted to leave you with is to say that, coming back to my first slide, in order to achieve quality listening, we have to radically change, and here I'm talking about medical professionals, but also the broader environment of authorities, etc., to radically change the mentality that has been in existence for the past 5 decades, to see the different players differently, to stop thinking of patients being in the shadows, that they should be more central to the question in terms of their voice, of their understanding, their experiences in particular. But also we should be asking ourselves how this new approach can change the way we think, we exchange, and really create a break in this hierarchical structure. And this means then there has to be a willful desire to build again trust, allow patients to speak out and engage in active exchange. Thank you very much. Right. Now we can move on to our next speaker. We're going to hand the floor to Arlene Bierman, who is going to talk to us about assessing patient experience of care, patient-reported experience measures, PREMs, and patient-reported outcome measures, PROMs. So these are complementary methods and approaches, placing the patient at the center of treatment quality.
So I'm going to try to shorten my talk a little bit to make sure we have a little more time for discussion, but there's a lot of documentation on our website. I've provided links, and I'm happy to provide people with more information if they have more questions. But patient-reported experience measures, PREMs, and patient-reported outcome measures, PROMs, are complementary approaches to engaging patients in improving healthcare quality. So the CAPS family of surveys ask about patients' experience with their care, and CAPS surveys are based on what patients say is important to measure. So I'll give you some information about the CAPS surveys that have been developed by AHRQ. But more importantly, a big priority for us now is how do we use patient-reported outcome measures to improve quality of care and patient experience, because they foster the incorporation of patient goals and preferences into shared decision-making and care planning. So what is CAPS? CAPS is a family of surveys. It stands for the Consumer Assessment of Healthcare Providers and Systems. And CAPS is a family of surveys and supplemental item sets that measure patient experience in a really diverse group of healthcare settings. It develops standardized surveys and related products according to established principles. And surveys assess quality of care from the patient's point of view. And there's a lot of published guidance on how to use and interpret the CAPS surveys. And studies the use of CAPS, how do we use this actually to improve quality of care? So the core principles of the design of the CAPS surveys is they focus on topics for which patients are the best or only source of information to evaluate care, and it includes patient reports and ratings of experience. So, and I want to make the distinction between experience and satisfaction, because they don't measure satisfaction. They include questions and domains for which the facility provider is accountable and for which we can risk adjust. And question items and survey methods are developed and tested with rigorous scientific methodology, and they incorporate extensive stakeholder input. And questions are based on current practices and standards of care. So those are the core principles of design. And just remember, we're capturing the patient's actual experience in care, not how they rate their satisfaction. So CAPS are actually a family of multiple surveys aimed at, they're specific to different facilities, healthcare sectors, so hospitals, hospice, outpatient and ambulatory surgery, nursing homes, home health, et cetera. There's surveys for the health plan level, and in the US we have different types of health plans depending on the payer, and also on providers and practices. So there's clinician and group surveys, there's accountable care organization surveys, and surveys for the patient-centered medical home. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about hospital CAPS, which I guess is similar to the ESAT here. And this has been in use for quite a number of years in the U.S., and it measures experience of care in most inpatient hospitals in the U.S. right now. In 2015, there were over 4,000 hospitals that reported CAPS scores on more than 3 million surveys. And the survey contains 25 items covering communication with doctors and nurses, responsiveness to patient needs, pain control, communication about medicine, care from doctors, transition to post-hospital care, cleanliness, quiet, and global ratings, and 7 about you questions to get demographics and information about the patient. It provides objective and meaningful hospital comparisons on topics that are important to patients and consumers. So Age caps now is mandated. It's required by the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, which funds Medicare healthcare for people over 65 in the U.S., and Medicaid, which is healthcare for low-income persons in the U.S. And it's actually incorporated now in value-based purchasing, which is a big priority in the U.S., and 25% of the total performance score in 2016 is tied to their reimbursement. So in terms of drivers and incentives to transform cultures, this is a big one. And then the HCAP scores are also publicly reported for consumer choice. So anybody can go online, you could look at this. There's a website called Hospital Compare, and anybody could see the ratings of the different hospitals in the US in terms of their results on these surveys. So does all this make a difference? Actually, there's more and more evidence growing that this has been a driver in improving patient engagement with health systems. This was one study by Mark Elliott that was recently published that looked at the second to fifth years of public reporting of CAP scores and actually showed overall increases in quality improvement in these scores across the U.S., and that the improvement was greatest for hospitals initially scoring the lowest. So that's something that's a positive sign. There was a recent study in JAMA Internal Medicine by Levine and colleagues, which I thought was very interesting. In the US, there was a landmark study over a decade ago by Beth McGlynn that showed that in ambulatory care, about half of patients don't get indicated guideline-concorded care. And this study followed up over a decade later to say what's improved. And actually, the quality measures in terms of chronic disease management, a lot of the clinical quality measures have been flat over time. But the one area where there was actually improvement in the US over the last decade overall was in patient experiences of care. So we can't attribute it to the survey, but it's one of the many things that's been driving attention to the patient experience. So I'm going to switch and talk really briefly about an area that I'm really passionate about, is the use of patient-reported outcome measures to improve care. This is a busy slide, and maybe just for time I'll skip over it, but this is from a paper that was in Health Affairs in the last year by Daniel Laval and Pat Franklin, which really talks about the collection and use of PROMs in learning healthcare systems and how to use this to advance health system improvement. And my next slide goes into more detail. So the idea is to collect this data and in one time and then use it for multiple purposes. So for patients and clinicians, PROMs can inform individual patient care decisions, goal setting, support patient management. For hospital leaders and clinicians, they can be used for quality improvement. For insurers and hospital leaders, it can be used for value-based purchasing. But important for researchers, primary care, and public health, really can generate new knowledge about what works to improve meaningful outcomes to patients. So basically, our goal is to implement PROMs in routine care, and it's the potential to improve care by orienting clinicians and clinician leaders to the outcomes that are most meaningful to patients, and facilitates the prioritization and ultimate effectiveness of care. And it's especially relevant for people with multiple chronic conditions where it's a summary outcome measures for the net sum of their care from multiple providers and multiple settings. And understanding patients and families' life circumstances, preference, and values is essential in making shared decisions about care in the larger processes of care. And having these measures that are meaningful for patients can really help inform that conversation. We've done a number of expert panels. This is a priority for us in terms of what are the challenges and opportunities for health systems in adapting PROMs. And, you know, there's multiple barriers. Clinicians don't know how to interpret the score. So one of the things we're working on is developing appropriate criteria. There's too many PROM measures, what to use. We want to develop some consensus of some standard measures to use. And it's a really challenging to gather and import, present, and PROM measures in a usual way. And we're really working with ways and developing apps with the EHR to make it easier to use and track these measures. So we have experience with PRO implementations in a number of settings. One was forced TJR for hip and knee replacement. Can patients walk? Are they mobile? Do they have pain after hip and knee replacement? The CERTAIN network looked at management of low back pain and neck pain, and also the DARTnet looked at management and was able to improve management of depression by using patient-reported outcome measures. So I'm just going to stop there, and thank you.
Right on time. Merci beaucoup. Thank you. Nous allons à présent nous pencher sur les résultats.
Now we're going to look at PROM results and in paramedical consultancy surgeries. We're going to hand the floor now to Philippe van der Vis, who's senior researcher at Scientific Institute for Quality of Healthcare in the Netherlands. Thank you very much. You have the floor. Thank you very much.
Good morning.
Bonjour.
Last night we had a wonderful dinner with the hosts and our speakers of today's conference, and we talked about how important it is that we really put patients in the center of care, and I will talk about how patient-reported outcomes can contribute to patient-centered care and improvement of quality, and I will sort of follow up on Arlene's introduction to patient-reported outcomes. And I would like to start with an example, a bit unfortunate, of my own left knee. I sprained my knee about 4 weeks ago, so I sprained it when running up the stairs. It really hurt. I couldn't walk up the stairs, down the stairs anymore. I had a lot of pain, and I could not do any cycling. So I made an appointment with my physical therapist, and she said, well, you can come over tomorrow. And she sent me an email with a hyperlink to a questionnaire. So I filled out in that questionnaire about my pain, about things I could do, could not do. So I filled out that questionnaire. And when I came to her office the next day, she had that questionnaire on her desk, and she said, oh, I can see what your problems are, and can you tell me about it? So I talked about my problems, and she said, well, what does really worry you? What is your main question? What is your main problem? And I said, well, next week I have a weekend with my friends. We're going cycling, mountain biking, and I'd like to be able to do that. Can I do that? So we talked about it, and she advised me and reassured me that if the pain would be lowered enough, it would be no harm to do the cycling. She said, well, just do it if you can think it's possible, and if there's not too much pain, there's no damage, you can really do it. So the next weekend, I was able to cycle, was very happy to go with my friends, and everything went well. And then I went back this week to see her again, and she again sent me a link to fill out that question, the same questionnaire again, and I scored much better, much higher. So she could say, well, you're doing much better on every functioning. You can cycle, you can walk the stairs again. So happy for you. There's no need to see you any further, and you can just go ahead and do your own things. So this is an introduction how patient-reported outcomes can be used in clinical practice. And actually, they sort of clarified the next few slides I have on that. So I was asked about my pain, about my walking, about my cycling, which is an outcome, a patient-reported outcome. And you can measure those outcomes with a questionnaire, the PROM. In this case, it was a questionnaire about my knee functioning. This is an example of a hip osteoarthritis and outcome scale, which is about hip problems, where you can measure that. And I was one patient of that physical therapist, but she has many patients with knee and hip and other and low back pain problems. And if she collects all the data of all these different patients, it gives her an impression of her own quality, what her own performance is in looking at all her patients together when measuring the outcomes of the patients before and after treatment. So that's what we call the PRO-PM, the patient-reported outcome performance measure. And what we like to do, and that's exactly as Arlene introduced as well, if we can use these outcomes in clinical practice by using them between the clinician and the patient in shared decision making, and then use the collected data at your own organization for quality improvement, and maybe even for public reporting, you can have different purposes for using these patient-reported outcomes. And my ideal picture, hopefully this will something that, that will happen in the future, it's already happening some at some places, but it could be better, is that this could be the integrated picture. As I said, I filled out that questionnaire at home. My physical therapist talked about the results with me, and my results and all the results of other patients come into a big database, and then they're being fed back to the physical therapist and maybe even published in a public report. So the integrated data collection is very important, and I think that's the future where we're heading. And I'd like to show you one example that we are, a project that we're doing in physical therapy in the Netherlands, to see if it's possible to collect this data in an integrated level, and also to see if we can improve the quality of physical therapist practice using patient-reported outcomes. So what we're doing is we're doing a project in which we are first trying to select the proper patient-reported outcomes and outcome measures to use in the project. Then we're going to collect data and see if we can make quality indicators from these outcomes that we've collected. And then we're starting to use the quality indicators for continuous quality improvement and see if we can use that for enhancing the quality of physical therapist practice. And in the end, we're trying to get some maintenance and evaluation, but we're not there yet. So we're about step 7 now in the project. So what we're doing is that we're measuring the outcomes of care, also processes of care, with for 5 main orthopedic conditions in primary care physical therapist practice: low back pain, neck pain, shoulder, hip, and knee, for 5 main issues there. And we collected data in a national registry. All these data from all these questionnaires being filled out are coming together in one big database. And that helps us to analyze the data and to see if we can use that for quality improvement. And that's what we're doing in the project. So this is the what the project looks like. We have about 600 physical therapists participating in this project from 179 practices throughout the country. So we have 5 or 6 projects going on, collecting data from different parts of the country. And they are collecting all this data for us. And as of January this year, we had 260,000 patients in that national registry. And actually, I looked up the data last week. The data from last week were that we have 600,000 patients in that registry. So the data is building up, and that gives us a lot of opportunities for analysis of the data and to see if we can compare outcomes between physical therapists. So one of the things that we do is that we can provide the outcomes and sort of provide transparency of outcomes. So this is for patients with reporting on their pain and their low back pain disability, and also about their neck disability. We have seen that in 80%, 81.9% of the patients, they really improved after physical therapist treatment. And for low back pain, they improved in 66.2% after physical therapist treatment. So this gives sort of an overview, as Arlene also said, about doing evidence, building evidence, and also doing research with data that we have collected here. But we can do much, much more things with the data. One of the things that we're doing is that we feedback the data to the individual practices. So this is a slide showing 44 primary care physical therapist practices who have collected data on low back pain of patients. And this is a score on the Quebec Back Pain Disability Score. So patients filled out a questionnaire before treatment, after treatment, and the difference in the scores is shown for each practice on this slide. The red horizontal line is the average difference between pre and post treatment, which is 23 or 24 points on that Quebec Back Pain Disability Scale. And some practices are scoring much higher than other practices who score lower than the average. This is case mix corrected data for age and chronic conditions and et cetera, et cetera. So these are valid figures showing that there are differences in outcomes between physical therapist practices. Now, what we do is that we show these data to the practices and try to give them information about how they can use this data for improving their practices. They start to learn from each other. How can it happen that your scores are much higher than my scores? What could explain the differences? What can I learn from that? So we do that in in two types of interventions. We do a peer assessment intervention, which is a small group of physical therapists, 5 to 7. They discuss such slides, the outcomes, with each other. Can you tell me what you do? What kind of treatments do you have? What kind of treatments do I do? Are there differences in treatments? What can I learn from you, and what can you learn from me? So we supervise these meetings by doing a continuous improvement cycle using the outcomes that we have collected. And the second intervention that we're doing is that we ask physical therapists to do a practice visitation. So one practice visits the other practice and backwards. And we're also showing these data, doing an audit of the outcomes of a practice in total and looking at the quality of the physical therapist practice using these outcomes as well. So the two interventions, one is at the individual physical therapist level, and this one is at the practice level. So we're using this data for quality improvement purposes. We are not at the end of the project yet, but what we can learn from being halfway the project is that we are able to provide outcomes, to show transparency of outcomes at a national and at the network level. The database is still a bit too small to provide data on individual physical therapist level, but we can use them for quality improvement purposes. And we realized and we found out that the use of this peer assessment and practice visitation is being highly appreciated with our participants. They really liked using the data for their quality improvement. So I think we're on the good track, and if we can collect more data, we can start building, developing the quality indicators. So I think with our project, we are on track, and we're on our goal, towards our goal to improve patient care and to improve patient-centeredness in care. So I think within a couple of years, we should be able to use it at a national level in the Netherlands. Thank you very much for your
time. Thank you.
Our last speaker will be talking about shared medical decision making. Thank you to Karen Sepucha for coming, assistant professor of medicine from the Harvard Medical School. You have the floor.
To share the work that we've been doing at Mass General Hospital to try and really give patients a voice in the decisions that they're made across the hospital about tests, about treatments, and so we'll be sharing some of that. So Massachusetts General Hospital is the largest and first teaching hospital for Harvard Medical School, so we do have an academic mission as well as a clinical mission. We have 18 adult primary care practices that are affiliated with the hospital. Some are located right at the hospital, and then many are actually in the surrounding communities. And what we'll talk about today is really focusing on how we've done integrating shared decision-making with those primary care practices. So we have over 250 or 260 physicians and nurse practitioners at those practices that care for over 200,000 patients. Now, back in the late 1980s, some researchers at Mass General were one of the first to develop patient decision aids. I'm not sure if you're familiar with those tools, but they're educational materials to really engage and inform patients in decisions. But it wasn't until 2005, about 15 and 18 years later, that we started to first use those tools with our patients. So as you know, often happens with medical innovations, it takes a long time for things to get integrated into practice, even when it was built and designed right here in our backyard. So the mission, what we're really trying to do is promote conversations and systems of care that value the expertise of patients and families, that value the expertise of our clinicians, and that are really based on the best available clinical evidence for medical decisions. And this is when we're talking about shared decision making, this is sort of the definition that I'm using, really focusing on this kind of conversation. So what's needed? When we think about what we've had to do to try and figure out how do you really make this happen within a large hospital, first we need to think about the culture. We need a receptive culture on the part of our clinicians, the staff, the administration. We have very, very experienced clinicians who say, I know what the best thing is to do for my patients. So we need to change that kind of conversation and that dynamic. We also need to engage and inform our patients and families. We have many patients coming into the hospital expecting the doctor to tell them what to do. And if we start thinking about shared decision-making, that's a very different interaction to have when the doctor starts asking more questions or thinking about what does the patient want to do. That's a very different kind of conversation. And then we need to develop the systems, the infrastructure, the resources to make this happen reliably throughout the hospital. So one of the things I'm going to talk about just today, because we have a little time, is talking about what we've done with the use of patient decision aids. And as I mentioned, these are educational materials that help focus on providing information about options, risks and benefits of those options, and help patients clarify their preferences. They're available in all sorts of different media, online, paper-based ones, videos. And there's a very large evidence base about these tools, so they've been used in more than 115 randomized controlled trials that have shown these kinds of educational tools really do improve patients' knowledge. They reduce decisional conflict, meaning patients are more able to make a decision. They increase patients' desire for participation in decisions, and they often, in certain situations, might reduce surgical rates. So when patients are more informed about the risks and benefits, they're less likely to choose more invasive treatments. So we have about 40 decision aids that we've been using at MGH. And over the past 10 years since we've worked on this project, about 35,000 have been disseminated out to our patients. Right now, we're doing about 1,000 orders a month. And those are some of the most popular topics, so treatment of insomnia, anxiety, chronic low back pain, knee osteoarthritis, and prostate cancer screening. So when we go out to talk to our physicians and the practices about, you know, using shared decision-making, thinking about decision aids, we hear a lot of different challenging situations that they deal with. So our doctors are dealing with patients who have too many questions. Doctors are dealing with patients who don't ask any questions, and then they're worried if they're really making a good decision together. They have challenges. They're not always confident discussing risks and probabilities without confusing either themselves or their patients. They often tell us that their patients don't really want to be involved. They want them to make the decision for them. And they often complain that there's just not enough time to do all the things that we're asking them to do. So we deal with all of these things, and I'm going to tell you two different stories about how we've been dealing with those. So the first was sort of when we focused on learning from our bright spots. So when we took over the program, I took over the program in 2010, and we were delivering about 100 decision aids a month, and that was pretty stable. And what we found was that 10 physicians accounted for 40% of all of those orders. So this wasn't a very distributed program. It was a very, very small group of providers who were using these. So we went out and interviewed all of those docs and said, well, nobody else is using them. Why are you guys using them? What did you see in these? What's important to you? Why are you taking the time to do it? And what they found, what we heard, was that they were really comfortable with the content. They'd always watched a program. We've been using some video decision aids. They'd watched a program. They really thought the content was very high quality. They all could recount an experience where it had completely changed the course of care for a patient. Either they had been completely surprised at what the patient wanted after watching this, so they hadn't guessed right. And so we developed a training program and delivered it out to all of the different practices that, you know, incorporated some of these insights. And what we found, let me get these off. So what we found after delivering the training is that just, you know, talking to the practices, having them hear about these stories from the often physician within their own practice who tended to use them, really increased the amount of decision aids that were ordered. So we nearly tripled the number of decision aids that were ordered. So some of the lessons learned, you know, certainly the comfort when you're thinking about integrating new tools or programs, comfort with the content of these materials is very important. Comparative data, you saw some on the physical therapists. We did provide comparative data to our physicians, both within their own practice, who's been ordering decision aids, and then across practices. And we have a very competitive set of clinicians at MGH. And now, so what happened was, you know, over the course of probably several years, the physicians got pretty comfortable with this and the idea of using decision aids. And then they realized that they were themselves being the big barrier. You know, they had to remember to do this in a visit. They had to remember which topics we had. And they were comfortable enough now with the program. They said, well, I'm kind of the barrier. Is there someone else that can do this? How can we really think about, you know, does it have to just be all on me? Can someone else do it? And so that's the next project that I wanted to talk a little bit about, was ways we've decided to start thinking about how do we harness the patient's power? Because even though this was a shared decision-making program, the way that it was integrated was the physician would have a discussion with the patient, decide that they were having a good topic of conversation, that we had a decision aid available. They would order it through the electronic medical record, and then it would get sent off to the patient. But it was a very physician-driven process. And what we decided to do was try and open that up. A lot of the work that we've been doing lately at Mass General and primary care is about team-based care and primary care patient-centered medical home. And one of the projects they were doing was a big project in mental health. So they were integrating a depression screen, actually the PHQ-2, for all patients coming in for annual visits were getting screened for depression. And one of our primary care practices decided, well, now that we're doing this, maybe we could offer decision aids at the same time. And so the workflow that they had designed actually did take the doctors out of the workflow completely. So the medical assistants who were administering the questionnaire to screen for depression were engaged in this project and said, oh, well, if the questionnaire, if the patient screens positive, can we offer them some of the programs that we have on mental health? So we had three different topics that were available for mental health: insomnia, anxiety, and depression. And then a medical assistant would then just place the order in the medical record and the patient would get the material. So the doctor was pretty much out of the loop altogether. So what did we find? So the first thing we found was actually the very few of our patients screened positive for depression. So there wasn't very large uptake of this program when we really limited it to patients who screened positive. But then one of the medical assistants actually suggested, well, can we just offer the programs to everybody and say, you know, see who is really interested in these kinds of programs, especially for the types of programs, insomnia, anxiety, and depression, where often it's if the patient really wants that information, that's a good indicator that it's something that's a big deal for them. So we changed the program, so the medical assistant started offering it to all patients. And what we found is in 1 month, 200 patients asked for these programs. So a tenfold increase in use of these programs for mental health. I think we're severely underestimating some of the patient demand for good information and for engagement on these projects. So some of the lessons learned here, in the provider-dependent workflow, I think really can limit the use and engagement of patients. We think the patients should be active participants in ordering decision aids, and that all members of the care team, medical assistants, nurses, also can help and really be involved in supporting patients to make good decisions, not just the physician and the patient. So one of the nicest parts of running this program is we get lots of thank you notes from our patients. So these are a couple of thank yous from our patients who really appreciate getting this information and appreciate being able to really be engaged. And we also get a lot of thank yous from the providers who really find that the interactions with their patients are very different when the patients come really informed and ready to have these questions. And they really like engaging in the higher level discussion that ensues. So instead of describing what the knee is, if it's a patient's coming in for knee pain, they can really be talking about the kinds of things they might be able to help with. So thank you.
Thanks a lot. Merci beaucoup, Karen Sepucha.
Thank you very much, Karen. Now, with no further ado, I'm going to hand the floor to Angela. Can you just tell us what do you take away from this second session? What surprised you? What's the takeaway points?
This has been a very important session because it's made the transition for us from collective engagement in systems to individual patient involvement. And I take away really two important lessons. The first is that measurement is very important, but it's never enough. You will notice that all of the speakers talked about how they needed to engage the providers in working with the measures, in learning the lessons that the measures tell us. Martine talked about a revolution, a radical change in the way clinicians work with patients. But that's not going to happen if you just sit back and publish your survey results. We've been doing in England, I helped the Department of Health get off the National Patient Survey Program off the ground, and every healthcare facility now surveys their patients every year. And we've been doing it since 2002. And we sometimes look at the results and get depressed because they're showing they're pretty flat. We know that there have been improvements. And we also know that where the improvements happen is where there's something else has happened to encourage them. We started from the same basis, actually, as the CAP surveys. In fact, the PICA surveys were the precursor of both the British surveys and the CAP surveys. And the original belief by the politicians who introduced this system was that somehow or other competition would drive up quality and that patients would make choices. They would use the data and make choices about which provider to go to. That hasn't happened. The changes have come because providers have used the data, not because patients have used the data. But I think what we're learning from PROMs, and Philip talked about this, is that when you actually use the PROMs data to help check whether patients' goals and patients' capabilities are being incorporated into clinical practice, then also you see a difference. So it's data measurement coupled with incentives for providers to change the way they work with patients that seems to be the answer. So then the question is, how can this be adapted to the French context? Because we found that in England, it didn't work the way some of the American advisors thought it would work, because we have a very different system, a much less market-based system. And in France also, you have a very different system from the American one and indeed from ours. So which of these aspects of incentivizing change will work in France?
Merci beaucoup. Thanks a lot.
Well, thank you very much. Catherine Grenier, you have the floor. I'm going to give you a microphone. You have the tall order of answering this question. Do you think that there are lessons that France can learn? Well, yes, absolutely, of course. I think that we are on a very long and complicated path, but we are progressing. And the introduction of film about the e-CETIS device, or system rather, is one of the tools that allows us to go forward. Now, we could go back to the definition of satisfaction and experience of patients, but in the e-CETIS questionnaire, there are global or general comments from the patients that are really useful to start a dialogue. The experts of satisfaction, users, providers, all of these stakeholders take part in the questionnaire. I think that this is very relevant in France. Now, we know that it is a crucial part of what we do in France, but the main part of it all is the actual dialogue between the patients and their doctors, so as to improve in the long run the quality of healthcare. And also, we need to make sure that doctors see the good side of all of this, because it needs to be a win-win situation between doctors and patients, for everybody to be motivated and on board. E-CETIS is a questionnaire that opens up new avenues for progress in France, for patients in hospitals and outside of hospitals. It really holds a great potential, and we also need to work on better sampling to develop PREMs and PROMs. But I know that it's not enough. It's just a first step. In fact, at the HAS, we are working on patient implication in different areas. We are also working with the Patient Information Commission on collective decision making by trying to provide tools to patients, sending them documents under different formats, information that basically helps them to have a proactive role in shared decision making. So I think that also is an important path for the future. So we're very optimistic here. Well, thank you for your optimism, and I'd now like to give the floor to Catherine Grenier, Director for the Improvement of Healthcare Quality and Safety, and member of the Patient Information Commission. You have spent a lot of time on the issue of shared medical decision making. What have you heard during the presentations of this session that took you by surprise about care for patients? sometimes the timing is not enough. Sometimes you need a lot of time to achieve good results. Well, thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank Agnès Buzat, the chairwoman of the HAS, and all the people who've organized this fantastic symposium. I've heard many amazing and surprising things this morning. I'm glad to see that many countries are very proactive, even in France. And if you're all here today, it's because you care about patients more than anything else. Unfortunately, it's not always the case out there in the real world, or at least in France. We talked a lot about collective implication in the first session and personal implication in shared decision making in the second session, which is much more complicated on a practical level. For example, recently I was invited to a ethics committee in a hospital in Paris, and we talked about shared decision-making. And I was very surprised to see all of these healthcare professionals on the ethics committee who were fighting about how to take a decision together. The nurse was saying that she had no say, the GP said more or less the same, and they were fighting about it. So we're really very far away from our objective in that manner, in that way. It's probably because of the French culture. We talk a lot about care, about terminology, should it be called care or not. And it's the same for shared medical decision. I think we don't have to keep medical, it's just shared decision making, that's it. And I think that this would help us forge ahead and with this new definition, patients really have a voice. In France, the system is very paternalistic, and people have a lot, sometimes too much respect for doctors. Maybe we need to change our culture. Cameron, you're talking about the barriers or what doctors thought were barriers for their patients. I'd like to talk about the other perspective, what patients believe to be barriers in doctors. The first argument we hear about is the fact that there's not enough time. Now, in France, it is true that patients see their doctors only for a very short amount of time, and time is of the essence in France more than anywhere else. But decision-making or shared decision-making allows us to organize the first encounter with the patient, because you have to listen, hear, negotiate, and then the next appointments will probably be much shorter. And then what about the responsibility of doctors? I think that we haven't really understood the concept of shared decision making, because responsibility does not lie only on the patient, but also on the doctor. And this is something that we have not fully understood yet in France. Very often people say that patients are shocked, overwhelmed, they're not able to make decisions. Well, they might be overwhelmed for a while. I mean, 16 years ago, a doctor told me that I had cancer. Yes, I was overwhelmed. Yes, it was a big shock. But a few days afterwards, I was back to normal and able to make a decision. And then some doctors say, my patients say, well, what would you do if you were in my shoes? They don't want to make a decision. And it's true that some patients don't want to make decisions, and we shouldn't force them to do that if they don't want to. But it goes back to the anti-internet argument. There's some people who don't know how to use the internet or who don't have access to internet. Does it mean that no one should have access to the internet? No. The solution is to help people who don't have the internet, don't know how to use it, to use it properly. So it's really a problem that has to do with culture. In the internet era, where patients have a lot of information at their fingertips, we are talking about here personalized medicine. Personalized medicine is not high-end, high-tech medicine. It's just a medicine where the patient is at the heart of the system, where they talk about their values, their culture, etc. And in an era such as the one that we are living in right now, we cannot do without shared decision making, even though it's not always the case in the real world. Well, but I think that one of the solutions is to look at tools, as we do here at the HAA, so what Thomas and Olivia mentioned earlier, the training of doctors with patients, which is what we do at our university in Paris, where shared decision making is at the heart of what we teach. Thank you very much. Right, I'm going to give you the floor to each and one of you, but just a very short comment so that we can have enough time for a Q&A session with the people in the room. Martine, could you tell us, is it complicated once that you've collected the information to see what you can actually do in practice? Well, I'm going to answer your question, but just before, I'd just like to go back to eSatis, that survey, the fact that you could add general comments in the survey. This is really a very rich potential that we can tap into, provided we've got the right tools, of course. But I think that we do have these tools, we do have the right analysis methodology. I think we should need to tap into this huge potential. And we can use it in many different areas. We've had many examples, in fact, during this session. Because the analysis and the way in which the results of this these analyses are shared to practitioners, patients, can be really very effective to improve the overall quality of healthcare. And bringing people together around the same table is crucial. That's what we are trying to do, to organize a dialogue between researchers and patient associations based on data and on facts and figures. These results, these outcomes must also be challenged through dialogue with patients and with healthcare professionals, so that all these stakeholders can take ownership of these outcomes. So it's a whole culture based on debate that we need to bring about. Karen, we started preparing for this symposium. You talked about the question of how can we engage patients, sorry, how can we engage doctors to engage with patients? How were you able to onboard them?
It's something that we've been working on, as you can see, for 10 years now. This is a project that has been going on. And I think for some of our clinicians, they realized it wasn't going away and that they were going to have to think about shared decision making one way or another because it just kept coming up. And we, you know, a lot of this is really face to face. We go out and meet with the clinicians. This isn't something that it's sort of coming top down either. Mm-hmm. Our medical director, when we had those 10 physicians who were ordering, you know, all of those programs, we invited one to be our medical director. And so it's kind of coming from them, you know, one of their peers to figure out why does this make sense? How do you use this in your practice? What does it mean? And they hear from, you know, their peers, and that works, I think, really well. And the other thing, I think once they try it, and they get the patient feedback that the patients really like it, then they're happy with that. You know, they want to do well with their patients. They're feeling stressed, and this is actually one way they can do well without having to do too much.
And so they realize that the impact is very positive in the way that they work. Is that correct?
Yes, they've gotten lots of good feedback. Yeah.
Une autre question que vous avez, un point que vous avez souligné que j'avais pas pensé.
And something else that you underlined, but that I had not noticed. What do we do with patients who don't necessarily speak the same language, or you know, have a very different social level, for instance, and maybe find it difficult to understand these issues?
So I think it's even more important to help figure out ways to engage those patients who may not have. So in the U.S., you know, if English isn't their first language, or folks who come from more underserved populations. So we do have three community health centers, and those are the main patient populations at the community health centers. And what they did was actually did some of that patient self-ordering, where they actually opened it up to their patients, because they had been very hesitant to even use decision aids with their patients because they thought they wouldn't really want to be involved. And the doctors had started ordering you know, prostate cancer screening tests, colon cancer screening tests, advanced directives. Those were the top decision aids that the doctors ordered. And they ended up doing a project where they opened it up to patients. And the patients came back and ordered the chronic low back pain, insomnia. You know, so once they sort of started to ask patients, what's on your mind, what are you interested in, they found a lot of differences from what their patients were thinking about and worried about than what our physicians were. And that actually helped them develop new programs. So it has been actually even more used in some of our community health centers.
On va passer la parole à Philippe van der Weis à côté de vous.
Okay, moving on to Philippe van der Weis. We've talked about health centers. Can we also apply that to ambulatory care?
Yes, certainly. I think we can apply it to any healthcare facility, because we've done projects in hospitals, in ambulatory care, in primary care centers. So I think it works everywhere. As long as, I think we discussed most of these issues already, the patients are involved, the clinicians are involved, and they together work on collecting the data and make sure that it has a meaningful application to it. I think that's the most important thing.
Merci beaucoup. On va donc maintenant passer la parole.
Thank you. So now it's over to you. We have 10 minutes for your questions. Okay, that's not too bad. And gentleman over here has had his hand up for a while now, I think.
Oui, merci. Donc ce colloque.
Thank you.
So
this conference is setting a precedent, but I think it's not completely in sync with the day-to-day reality that you, madam, were talking about. Yes, as far as, you know, organizations go, institutions go, working groups go, etc., we have patient representatives. They are doing their thing. Are they being listened to? That's another topic. But in daily life, I think that, you know, the dialogue is not moving forward. So first question, how do we set up a partnership with the means that we currently have? Because beyond the cultural medical barrier, we have less and less nurse time, don't we? And for the last few decades, it's really the nurse who is the interface between the institution and the patient. It is that person who decodes the medical terminology to turn it into plain speaking information that the patient can understand given their personal context. It's often the nurse who is there to listen to the patient. Often it's the nurse who is there to help and support the patient, give the meaning to their patient, to reassure them. And patients, nurses have less and less time to do this. So that's one question. Second question, how can we really cater to the individual, whereas the overall logic is moving to more an industrialization of, you know, approaches and homogenization? You know, we want standards. We want to roll out standards and benchmarks, et cetera, et cetera. My third question, on health needs with the aging population and chronic pathology, that is 4% per year increase, okay? So the budget. Sorry, to answer your question, let me hand over to Angela straight away. So my question is, how can your authority impose your qualitative vision of things to a ministry who has to cut budgets?
I have no comment to make on your budget. But you raised a very important issue, I think, which is about this sort of standardization. You called it industrialization of healthcare. Healthcare is very much nowadays governed by guidelines and protocols and safety laws and so on. And you're right. I think there is, it does come up against the what you've been hearing from my fellow panelists about engaging patients, about listening to their goals, responding to their needs. I think it is a contradiction that we have to deal with. I think that the patient of the future will expect a much more personalized service. And I think we're going to move away from the rigidities of guidelines. We won't, I hope, move away from evidence, but the evidence is going to have to be shared with patients, and patients are going to have to be listened to. Their priorities are going to be what governs how the health professional responds. And that means we will have to look again at some of those laws and regulations and ask questions about how appropriate they are once we have patients who are much more engaged and much better informed and able to find information on the internet than they ever were in the past.
I just wanted to add something to what's just been said. It is not set in stone that it's up to nurses to talk to patients. It's also up to the doctors to do it. So you are completely echoing what I tried to say at the beginning of our presentation. We are still living with representations that are 50 years old. We need to turn that system upside down. Otherwise, nothing will change. Thank you, Jean-Pascal Ansolivier from the A de Pas Association for Amputee Patients Associations. The driver, if I might call it that way, of the health system is the social security system, which in France finances the system. Now, how about trying to, you know, impact them and also research and training to try to get the health authority to have really an impact on the social security system? Let me try to answer that question. Of course, it's very complex, but I would nevertheless like to say that these challenges have been identified in France by the various ministries and social security. The various stages will be set out and implemented, but still some things have already begun, you know, an encouragement for quality. We are moving towards quality assessment throughout the system and rewarding that. As far as financing these establishments goes, and also with the ROSP system in ambulatory care. Again, we've tried to encourage more quality. I think there is a huge potential there. Some things are being done. But of course, our action is also about publishing and adding value and promoting these pilot projects in France so that everyone gets on board. I think that's part of our role. Thank you very much. There was also a question from the gentleman over there who had his hand up for a long time. I'm very sorry. You've been asking since this morning. I'm trying to stick to an order here. Thank you, Philippe Trell. I'm from Research and Development, AXA Insurance. I have a question for Mrs. Bierman. I would like to know what you think about ISHOM, the International Consortium on Health Outcome Measurements. Do you think that the standards set by this organization are useful to share?
I can't comment specifically on their recommendations, but I do want to say that it is really critical to standardize measurement. And we have a couple of projects within our own agency where we're trying to standardize, get consensus about patient-reported outcomes measures across disease registries so that we could pool data and learn across different registries, different diseases. So I think that's a critical effort. And I think it's going to take a lot of work to get a consensus because everybody has their favorite measure. And just in terms of the tension between guideline concordant care and measures, there's a lot of work going on in the US now on measures that matter. And how do you create quality measures that take into account patients' preferences and goals? And there's work being done on something called goal attainment scaling. So as Philip was saying, if you have a patient-reported outcome and you can talk to somebody, what do you want to achieve? Do you actually achieve that goal? And so the quality measure is progress to that individual goal rather than adherence to a specific guideline which may or may not be relevant to that patient. And I just want to give a contrast to Philip's example. As I was preparing this talk before I came here, one of my colleagues, her son is 15 years old, and he broke his ankle after being very diligent in making it onto the varsity soccer team, football team. And he went back to, he was casted, he went back to the physician, he goes, oh, you're better now. And basically said, oh, kids do fine. But he wanted to get back to playing. His goal was to be a competitive football player. So his, you know, parents had to go and they found physical therapy and he was able to do that. But without asking patients, what is your goal? You know, you could walk, you're fine. Well, that's not where we want to be. So I think asking these kind of questions and having standardized measures to do that can help us, drive us in that direction.
Merci beaucoup.
Thank you very much. Angela Coulter, did you have something to add?
Yeah, just an advertisement. Mm-hmm. This year, next summer, the International Community of Researchers in Shared Decision Making is coming to France for their two-yearly annual conference. So it'll be in the University of Lyon in July. So I do hope some of you will come along to that.
Thank you. Monsieur.
Oui, bonjour à tous.
Last question. Georges-Alexandre Humbert, Victim Assistance Association linked to drug usage. So I have a thank you to the HAS, which has accepted a warning on sleeping pills and tranquilizers. It's an alert that's currently underway, and hopefully studies will be able to allow the number of suicides or attempted suicides to be lowered due to intake of these drugs, 200,000 a year. Now, I will have a question about patient associations when they are deciding on prescribing drugs. This morning on the radio, I heard, for instance, the Depakine scandal, about the Depakine scandal. Now, Depakine, a child who is going to be handicapped for life can cost 10 million euros to society. So I thought, you know, this is great. The ministry is setting up a compensation fund. Maybe it's because we've got elections next year. But my question is the following. After this Depakine scandal, I took my medical dictionary and I saw or discovered that the doctor is still allowed to prescribe Depakine to pregnant women. And on top of that, the patient, this pregnant woman, epileptic pregnant woman, this poor woman who is still fragile, is part of the decision. I mean, we are still giving women Depakine, just like thalidomide or Distilben, and it's an ongoing process. And finally, are certain women trying to have handicapped babies to get compensation? That's what's happening in some countries, like India. Okay, well, a last question. You, sir.
Thank you, Guy Volk, Chairman of AMACAP, National Association of Patients with Prostate Cancer. Don't you think that involving in people in strategic decision-making committees, I'm thinking about cancer patients, expert patients, representatives of association, patient associations. Don't you think that would really reduce over-prescription? That is really something that we don't like. Anyone want to answer that question?
Angela? Catherine, vous ajouterez, et on sera obligé de se terminer là.
There is quite good evidence that if you involve patients, if you give patients good, reliable, balanced, evidence-based information, and then in the, as Karen was talking about, in the form of decision aids, and then you encourage them to participate in medical decisions, it can quite often reduce the intervention rate. In other words, patients are often more conservative and more risk-averse than clinicians, and so they tend to often opt for the less invasive procedure. It's good news for policymakers. It doesn't always work, but certainly we see it in elective surgery. Patients are less likely to want the interventions when they know about the risks as well as the benefits.
Merci beaucoup. Merci de les applaudir encore une fois, s'il vous plaît.
Thank you very much to all our panelists. Thank you to you for having taken part. Let's meet back here at 2:10. Please be as prompt as you can. 2:10 after lunch for our third and final session. Thank you very much and enjoy your lunch.